To follow along with this tutorial, all you need is a tripod, your camera, and your kit lens. Even though I'm using the A6500 in this tutorial, you should be able to follow along with any of the A6000 series cameras. And also, you'll probably be able to follow along with any crop-sensored camera as well. The menu placements might be different, but the principle is the same. I have the kit lens, I also have a Lauer 12mm 2.8, and the Sony 10 to 18mm f4. With a kit lens at 16mm at its widest, this is the equivalent to around about 24mm on a full frame camera. The first thing you need to do is find a dark sky location. I do this by using the website www.lightpollutionmap.info. Basically, the darker the color on the map, the better the skies will be. So you need to be away from any big cities or big sources of light. I actually had to travel for 3 hours to get to the location to shoot this tutorial. And that's what you might have to do. You might have to find a dark location, or you might have to travel quite a way to get to a good location. Now, there is a scale called the Bortle classification. And basically what this is a scale of light pollution and how good or how bad it is. 9 is the worst, 1 is the best. If you look on lightpollutionmap.info and click on a location, it'll give you this Bortle rating. Anything with a Bortle rating of 5 or lower is really good. You can shoot the stars with higher ratings, but there'll be less stars in the sky because the light pollution will bleach out these stars. And if you can find a location with a Bortle classification of 2 or lower, that's fantastic, and you'll get some really brilliant night skies. As there's very little light about, the camera needs to be really good at low light capture. And the A6000 series of cameras are really good at this. If you pair this with a really good fast lens with basically a really wide aperture, you can get some really great images. If you do try this out and really enjoy it, it's worth getting a manual focus lens. The 12mm Samyang F2 is a great manual focus lens for this job. I could only borrow the 12mm Lauer, which is the more expensive one, but they are very close in image quality, and the Samyang is a lot lighter and a lot smaller. And it actually has a wider aperture of f2, which lets in even more light. The great thing with manual focus lenses are that once you know where the infinity point is, sometimes it's not quite on that infinity point that it's marked to on the lens, but once you know where this infinity point is, you can set it to that same point every single time. So these are the steps. Put the camera on a tripod. Make sure the back display is on. Turn the mode dial to manual. Turn on the self timer. I normally have it on 2 seconds. If your camera has it, turn off the steady shot. Turn off long exposure noise reduction. Change the file type to RAW. If you're using a zoom, zoom out as wide as possible. Change your white balance to incandescent. Switch to manual focus. If you have a marker on your lens, set your focus to infinity. If you don't, this is the tricky part. Set your ISO to about 10,000, the aperture as wide as possible. This basically means your F number as low as possible, and your shutter speed to around about 6 seconds. Find a bright star that you can see on your display. You might have to turn the brightness of your screen up a little, and then use the magnify tool, making sure the bright star is in the magnify area. Now turn your focus ring until you can see the star clearly and in focus. This comes down to trial and error, and sometimes you might have to go backwards and forwards until you get that focus point that you want. Keep the focus in manual and try not to touch the focus ring. You should check your photos every now and then to make sure they are still in focus. If you've had to focus this way, come out of the magnify mode. Then take a shot. Depending on the moonlight and any ambient light from any cities nearby, your shot might be overexposed. If so, increase your shutter speed. This first step with having a really high ISO and relatively fast shutter speed is merely to quickly find a pleasing composition. Once you've got a good composition, start bringing your ISO down and lengthening your shutter speed. Just don't make the shutter speed too long, otherwise the stars will start to streak due to the rotation of the Earth. Now, when it comes to getting pinpoint stars, there's a rule with full frame cameras called the 500 rule. This is known as the 300 rule for crop sensored cameras. Basically, what you do is take the number 300 and divide it by your focal length. So with the 12mm that I have, you can have a maximum exposure of 25 seconds. With a kit lens at 16mm, which is its widest focal length, you can have a maximum shutter speed of 18.75 seconds. And with a 24mm, you can keep the shutter open for around about 12.5 seconds. To be honest, with a really fast lens and these modern cameras, you can be a little bit more conservative with your shutter speeds. But this is where it comes down to experimentation. You want to go out and take a few different shots at different exposure lengths and different apertures and different ISO settings. You'll have lots of time to experiment, and if you're in a dark, quiet location, you can basically camp and chill out and take loads of photos all the way through the night. You will be a little bit tired the next morning, so just be prepared for that. Then it's just a case of coming up with interesting compositions and following the patterns of the moon and the stars to see what might give you an interesting sky. I'm into wide field astrophotography, and that's where these wide angle lenses really come in handy. If you do some research into astrophotography, you'll find that people really get into this, and then they'll start getting things like trackers, telescopes, and get into deep space astrophotography. And there are some amazing photos of nebulas, gas clouds, and things like that. As I said, I'm only into wide field astrophotography, so all I need is a tripod, a camera, and a wide angle lens. If we look at these photos compared with the full frame camera I normally shoot with, it's really surprising how well the A6500 held up to the A7III. If you zoom in to 100%, even though the noise pattern is worse in the A6500, if you added some noise reduction to it, it would clean the image up nicely. The other option would be to take a sequence of shots and then use Starry Landscape Stacker or Sequiter and stack these images together to reduce the noise. If you want to see my video on stacking astro images, click on the eye in the corner or the link in the description.